So, welcome everybody to this online lecture. This is the first time I'm doing such a thing, and I'm interested in how it's going to spin off or turn out. The lecture of today is titled Utopia and the Sustainability of Potentiality, and it's a talk that where I'll go into my artistic research dealing with imaginary sound related to the project Music for the Inner Ear, which is a artistic research project I've conducted at the RMC, the Rhythmic Music Conservatory in Copenhagen. I think it's important to state before I start that this is artistic research. It's not academic research. And I say this mostly as a disclaimer in terms of, I think it's my privilege as an artist to also understand and misunderstand all kinds of sources if they end up in a new thinking or a new inspiration. So please go into this lecture with this notion that it's not an academic lecture, it's an artistic research lecture. And my name is, as you know, Niels Lyhne Løkkegaard, and I'm a composer and I'm a sound artist, and also back in the day I was educated as a saxophone player. So I've been in different fields, and within the last, since 2014, 2013, I've been working as a composer mostly, and in later years also worked a lot with non-sonic media, and my practice is, so to speak, now dealing with both sound, but also more like text-based work and also conceptual works that are not really detached to any sound manifestation. But I'll not go into that today. The plan for today is that first I will go in and tell you a little bit about the background, what led up to this interest in the imaginary sound and in the sonic potentiality, you could say. What were the reasons for me to engage with this field? And second, then I'll go into the concrete research project, Music for the Inner Ear, and talk a bit about the different outcomes and different artifacts I came across, or different notion and paradoxes and dead ends I encountered along the way. And then I'll talk a little bit in the end about the perspectives in terms of what's the horizon, and how can this knowledge gained from this project, how can that actually point to possible new futures or new solutions to different problems. As stated in the description of the talk, I'm interested in this notion about you could say that we live in a saturated time, and even our fantasy has become saturated with reality. So I'm interested basically in like rebooting our fantasy and thereby try to revitalize our imagination and our capacity to imagine futures and realities that are not there. So please write along the way if it doesn't work. I will share screen sometimes. And in the end of the talk, there will be hopefully some some time for questions, but it would be a rather condensed talk of 1 hour all in all. Prior to my work with imaginary sound, I worked a lot with the creating music that were performable, like physical sound, that we all know, like creating music that is performable by musicians and non-musicians. And I'm interested in how can I make a music that renegotiate some of the hierarchies of privileges in terms of who is allowed to create music and who's allowed to play music. And it ended up in a series of works where I multiplied instruments. I'm talking about physical sound. Among those was a piece for numerous triangles, for instance, which I hope you see now, which was performed at many places, but for one at the Roskilde Festival in 2017. This is a picture from that event. And along the way, I thought, okay, what could be the most extreme way of activating or inviting into this this practice of creating music together, or this way of empowering all individuals to be able to create, because I really think that all human beings have the capacity to create music. How could I make that accessible to a bigger crowd of people? And I thought to myself that the most extreme way would be to relocate the act of creating music within the mind of the listener, within this imaginary space. I call it music for the inner ear, others call it the mind's ear. And where then the listener / the reader would read about music and then create one's own soundscape or piece of music within the mind. There's nothing new in that. It's a long tradition since Duchamp, and it's a 100-year-long tradition. I think I was especially interested in about how I could describe these pieces for a larger crowd to imagine. And there I was also inspired by how it was back in 2015, how I noticed that, especially on Facebook, when a festival would launch its program, there would be like a kind of hype around the program of a festival, this beautiful curated festival program, and it was like there was like this love and attention and this sitter or this electric feeling surrounding the launch of the program more than actually the content itself, like the actual physical concerts. I did not feel the same electricity. It was more like about the story about this program. And then I was thinking, if you could say like the artistic experience, which would then be the experience of this program, if that's been elevated up to this narrative meter sphere, then I would also be able to enter there as an artist and also create music in this narrative space, which is about like how stories, like the story of a program or the story about a piece of music, then would become a piece of music. Like this interest in how stories can create or language creates reality. I would like to test that out and see if I could write music in text that would then unfold as music, but also write text in a really, you could say, really, really dull way. Like, because I was inspired by the language we used on social media, and I wanted to copy that kind of almost like, yeah, just really dull language and describe these pieces in text. So I embarked on that. From there, I began writing these pieces in text, and I'll go into that later. before we go into the actual project, music for the inner ear, that this interest for creating music as stories or this, I'll just show you a picture of a certain person. One moment. Yes, hope you see this. This is a physicist called Erwin Schrödinger, who was an Austrian physicist, and I think a lot of people think I think they know his thought experiment called Schrödinger's cat, which is this thing I'll show you now. Can you see that? Yeah. This is a thought experiment that came up because he was a part of that group of scientists in the 20s and 30s that dealt a lot with this new crazy thinking about quantum mechanics. That is about, and remember, this is, I'm not a scientist, but it's inspired me in this way, nevertheless. Quantum physics is about like particles can inhabit multiple states at the same time. Like a particle can be a wave or a photon, and these particles can be different places or the same place on top of each other. It's really hard to grasp, and it's the paradox is then when you then observe these particles in this like constant fluctuation between places or conditions, the what you then would observe would then like make the quantum universe collapse, because then the particle would turn into, you could almost say it would like freeze in on itself, and then you could not really observe the movement or the oscillation itself. And this guy, Erwin Schrödinger, he thought it was so ridiculous, that idea. So in 1935, he came up with this idea just to show how ridiculous it was, like the idea of Schrödinger's cat. And that is what you see right now in this box. And it was a thought experiment. And it was actually then a critique against like this way of interpreting like a quantum physics. Like imagine this, a cat is placed within a box, and also with that cat, a canister with poison, that would be this green one, is placed, and then a radioactive material, an unstable radioactive material is placed there, and then a Geiger counter. And then the thought experiment is about this. We don't know, looking from the outside, we cannot see through the box, we don't know if this radioactive material is going to decay or not, we just know it's unstable. If it decays, then the Geiger counter will react and unleash this hammer that would destroy this canister with poison, this bottle with poison, and the cat would die. It would be here dying, as you can see. Or the other scenario would be that the radioactive material would not decay, and the radioactive or the Geiger counter would not react, and the canister would not break, and the cat would be alive. It would be perhaps slightly bored within the box, but it would nevertheless be alive. So this notion of the cat being dead or alive from the outside, it would be both dead and alive, because we would not know how the outcome would be. And this position of being actually dead or alive, everybody could, of course, see. Schrödinger would think that would be ridiculous. And in a way, it is, because quantum physics, the laws of quantum physics doesn't apply to like larger scale physical objects. But Nevertheless, I think this notion of the cat being dead or alive, what in quantum mechanics is referred to as being within a state of a superposition, which means that it's partly this, but it's also this. That notion of being in a superposition is a key driver within my interest for this imaginary sound, and it's also a kind of an important key to go into my research, I think. So with that said, I think we should go into the project. I just closed these windows. Yes. So I just have to check if everybody's still with me on Facebook. I think it works still. Yes, good. So now you see the portal of my research project, Music for the Inner Ear. Just go to the big screen. An exploration of sonic potentiality. The sonic potentiality is a kind of my take on the superposition. That means like different possible realities, or different possible sonic worlds that I want to explore. We try to press one of these keys. Yeah, I began looking into this. Music begins where words begin, Goethe said, and when words leave off, music begins, so spoke Heinrich Heine, and Sibelius claimed that music begins where the possibilities of language end. This is like this kind of well-known dicta, you could say. And I'm always curious about looking into what is looked upon as being really stupid, actually. That is like, as I think some of the most interesting ideas are the stupid ideas. So I was interested in like turning this around and say like that music begins when words begin, claiming that music begins and it's detached to language. Of course, I have to say all this research is embedded with multiple paradoxes, and it's a way at a utopian project, because of course I know language also excludes. You could say language is really smart for us that understand English right now. That is super clever. But if you don't understand English, it's super excluding. And the same goes for of course creating music in a certain language. It also excludes some people. Nevertheless, I really wanted to look into this stupid idea. I found some inspiration in Niels Lyhne that writes like the phonetic alphabet forced the magic world of the ear to yield to the neutral world of the eye, and man was given an eye for an ear. And this project seeks to give back an ear for an eye. I was really interested in looking at the phonetic or the alphabet as such, like turning it back and say like in the dawn of alphabet was actually music for the inner ear. It was like, how can I capture the sound A and then try to make a sign for that sound? But then over the course of many, 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 many years, of course, language became in a way detached from the phonetic value of the sounds. So I was interested in like trying to go back again, to make like these words that would describe sound, but would refer to it with other meanings. So we would have like in these projects, there's so many translations going on. There's translations between, for me, Danish and English, and there's translation of meaning and sound, and there's translations from letter to word, and all these processes are going on at the same time, almost like in quantum physics. And I get really aware of how I activate certain like semantic part of my brain while trying to imagine some sound worlds on the other part of my brain, and it's it's yeah, like I really like this I think this interesting, this like all these processes going on at the same time. So yeah, potentiality, that was the same as I talked about before, like we often like enjoy the notion of potential, but with the expectation that the potential should actualize itself and become something physical. But I became intriguingly curious about like creating potentials that would never become anything else than a potential. And actually there's a word for that, and that is potentiality, like where the potential is given value in itself without the expectation of becoming something else. So now we'll go deeper into the project. Right now, as you can see here, we are about to embark into the project, and actually right now we are dealing with, we could almost say, like a superposition. All of us are in a superposition right now. You are in front of your computers, and I'm also in front of this computer, and we now have the option. I'm just dragging the speed here a little bit because I'm waiting for you. I'm waiting for you to pick up on me. But we have, right now we are in a superposition because we can decide, like we can go into the research and you will have an answer about how it turned out. You will be presented to all these pieces of music and not really pieces, yeah, of imaginary sound worlds, and you will be presented for all kinds of reflections and discoveries I did along the way. You will have your answer. You could also choose not to have the answer. You can read about here. I can tell you what happened. It says right here that what I came across, and we can choose to remain within this potential state of all these sonic worlds. You will never have the answer, and you will remain in this superposition. So already now we are beginning to train like this sense of embracing the superposition and not having the answer. But okay, let's decide, should we leave potentiality or remain within potentiality? What do you think? You can write here in our thread. I have to say, I really hope that you write leave, because it would be kind of a short talk otherwise, but that is also an option. Yeah, there's some delay, so please just give me a hint when you're there. Leave, yes, we'll leave. So here's like the timeline of this project. As you can see, it starts out with the me categorizing sounds. Prior to this project, I already had like written an entire symphony with text, which was kind of loaded with words of like descriptions of sound that were very like loaded with knowledge about sound. So it would exclude a lot of people who would not know anything about that. But still you would understand glimpses of it. But I decided for this project, I wanted to see if I could again go into this stupid idea or like utopian idea or this idea filled with paradoxes, that I wanted to pursue this idea of creating music that were non-metaphorical. And of course that is in itself is a paradox, because language is in itself is a paradox or is a metaphor, sorry. But I decided to try just to describe sounds. I would ended up in a kind of an anthology of sound at first, like just sound descriptions, and so on. A whining sound, deep sound, a low sound. Yeah, for a lot of pages, I would name these sounds, and then it would be up to the reader to or listener to evoke an inner sound world. And then the next step would be, sorry, I'll just go down here. That's a lot of pages, as you can see. One word on each page, because then if there was something over here, then you could not like evoke. I found out that it was really difficult to evoke an inner sound world. If there's something standing here, then you cannot focus on that. So I wanted to keep it super simple. And then each time you would turn a page, you could set the pace of the music, so to speak. But also I just fell totally in love with this super dramatic notion of what let's call it a book is capable of, in terms of when you turn a page, it's just so super dramatic. So I just wanted to emphasize just that drama. Next off, I wanted to describe sound in relation to the spatial qualities of sound, sound from one side, from the side, and sound from behind, and sound from below. I was curious in evoking kind of this abstract room, you could say, sound from the side, sounds from the sides, sound from above and below, sound from all sides, do-ka-do-ka-do. It keeps on and keeps on and keeps on and keeps on. This all took place within 1.5 years of working. It was not like this smooth thing. I go back to that later on. Actually, my process kind of collapsed along the way. Let's go back to that now. So we are here in sounds in space. I encountered resistance here along the way. It became so, you could say it's so conceptual effort to imagine music within one's mind. And I really missed like the bodily impact of sound and like a poetic warmth. And I also wanted to, I didn't want just to write imaginary music for the inner ear. I wanted to write good imaginary music for the inner ear. And I really did not think I was succeeding in that at that time. And I missed like the poetry in the language, and I got more and more fatigued. So at one point I reached like you could call it critical mass. Some of you as Terminator fans perhaps know this time here. It's like when Cyberdyne, not the year of course, but when Cyberdyne became active. Yeah. I reached critical mass, and I think that's interesting in terms of speaking about creative processes, that I really think that we always work in a state of becoming, that all these processes of working within a method and creating and reflecting is this wheel. And all these processes take place at the same time on top of each other. And that is like kind of an ongoing machine, you could almost say, or a system that unfolds itself. And then I was curious, because in this project, the method of writing music in text and categorizing these sounds and texts, that it was in a way of, I imposed a certain method on me for a long time. And looking back at it, I think what happened was that I froze time in a state of becoming, as I also write, like an energy got contained and encapsulated until critical mass was reached. It's like in a nuclear fission bomb. Then a chain reaction will happen, and a vast energy burst will occur. So, and that occurred for me on that date, and suddenly my project exploded. My process, I ended up like it got so saturated I couldn't go any further. So I decided to also step outside just writing music and text, and I began working with the film, for instance. Like, this is a piece for six violins, the Tableau du Son, it's called. And as it says, it's a piece for six violins performing a major third with a duration of 15 minutes. Even though it's just a major third, the sound of the six violins go in and out of phase, thereby causing the character of the major third to change in a microcosmos of constant drama. And then, of course, already now, you know how this will sound, and I could press play, and then you would feel the sitter of the potentiality like inflate. It would like implode. So I'll not do that. You know how it sounds? You could press here, and have the answer, but I'll not do that. As you say, see, I name Tableau du Son film and or sound and or installation and or music and or what's the last one? Sculpture, yeah. And I'll come back to that later. Also around here, I began also looking into, I had done that actually for quite some while, but it became more apparent for me now that creating this imaginary music with text wasn't that easy. I think some of the, it was easy, but sometimes you ended up reproducing music that was what was clearly feasible in a physical world. Like, it was possible to create this music. And I had this experience when writing the symphony number one. I wrote like this piece for microtonal crotal, which is an imaginary music instrument. Crotal is a real instrument, and it's a beautiful instrument, and it's an expensive instrument, and it's like these cymbals with this super beautiful crystalline sustain. I wanted to write music not for this normal crotal, but I would write for a microtonal crotal, and I looked into how what that would cost if you should have those built, and it would be insanely expensive. But still, I wrote this piece for a lot of microtonal crotal, and how they would interfere with each other and make like this really beautiful crystalline sound. But I wrote it anyway, and you can say that was really stupid, why write that? But then after a while, and that is one of the perspectives of doing this, going into this utopian space. After a while, I came across Toman.com, which some of you perhaps know. It's like an eternal an eternal like inspiration, source of inspiration to me, Toman.com. I go in there and look, hey, what do they have of crazy little instruments? And then I came across like these energy chimes, it's called, and like these metal rods you use for meditation. And they have the same qualities of a crotal almost if you play them with a violin bow. And then I just thought they were so way more cheaper. So I could buy a lot of those, and then I found out I could dismantle the metal rod, and I could go to this guy who makes shoes and stuff, and he would cut a little bit off, and then of course the pitch would then get higher if you cut something off a metal rod, and then actually I could build my own microtonal crow tower. And I, so I did, and that was really nice. And I made that, I made some physical music with that. And my thesis or my ideas is that if I did not in the first place allow myself to enter this utopian space of writing this piece for the microtonal crotal in text, then this idea of doing this when looking at Toma, it wouldn't have come to me. So I think when you allow yourself to enter utopia and write these descriptions and take the utopian space really seriously, then ideas can ricochet back again. So I think we should be careful in like saying that it's naive or it's stupid to go in and do like this, write this music that is not possible. Because it's also a way of sending an idea out, and then perhaps another one will come back again. So to get back to my research, at that time I also began working with other people. I asked them to write imaginary music thesis, both as a part of my teaching. I asked students, but also colleagues and fellow colleagues. And it just dawned on me that there was a lot of great works, but also a lot of works that were where the imaginary piece was like, as I said, really feasible and really possible to play. And that is also all right. But I just thought, why when going into Utopia, why like make like these pragmatic pieces of music? Why dream like rational dreams? Why don't we go full on into Utopia? And at that time, I also came across the work of Catherine Malabou, the French philosopher, who was a big source of inspiration to me in my work, partly due to her thoughts on like the explosion as a creative force, like as an escape. And there's no escape, as I talked about early on, in terms of the critical mass, but also in terms of this. That was the wrong one. Sorry. What happened to my? Just try this. Yeah, I hope this shows now. Yeah, where she writes like the new world order means the impossible of another. Why doesn't it show? I'll read it for you. Sorry, hang in there. That was the new world order means the impossibility of any exotic, isolated, or geopolitical marginal event. Paradoxically, the saturation of theoretical and natural space is felt like a vacuum. This sensation of saturation was something that really resonated with me, both in my daily life and in our physical aspects of the world, these systems we live in, but also I became more and more interested if also in fact our fantasy had become saturated, if our fantasy had been saturated as the same systems that actually that we try to escape or at least try to challenge when imagining new possible realities. So I became more and more curious about this, the perhaps like this fear almost that our fantasy has crumbled. And I really think in many ways it has. I think we are the reality, we often hear the notion, I think it's also stated in the description of this lecture, but like that we often hear like that sometimes reality exceeds fantasy. When something crazy happens, then we say that. But actually, I think that is more like general rule that the reality exceeds the fantasy and not vice versa. I think the fantasy in a way has been crumbled by the systems of reality, and thereby I think it's so important that we revitalize our fantasy, our imaginative skills, and dare to go full on into utopia, dare to articulate ideas that are not feasible, and really try to revitalize these ideas to see if we can escape this saturation. Perhaps we cannot, perhaps we are doomed, but I think we should try anyway. I'll just go briefly into the project again. I'll just show you some other stuff. I made the curatorium, which was a festival that is like a curatorial non-event, which presented artists from Denmark and abroad, and was actually kind of, as I talked about in the beginning, it's a program, it's a curation of artists, that were asked to articulate imaginary sound pieces or installations, and they would be posted here on Facebook. A curatorial non-event, and actually, it was quite inspiring. Many of the pieces, and people were asking, when does this take place? And it was kind of a fun thing to experience this kind of discussion, if it actually took place or not. And also, as you noticed, that was also utopian at that time, perhaps it still is, but actually the gender balance was 50-50. This curatorium, it says something about where we are at that point. And sorry for this, I pressed the wrong one. I'll go into this again. I also became to think a lot about how do we deal with rights, imaginary, if I say that the reader becomes the creator in creating its one's own soundscape, how do we then deal with copyrights? And I made this performance called Transfer of Value, where everybody would imagine a sound text piece, and then at the entrance of the event, they would write their name and address and their quota number, which in Denmark is a Danish copyrights organization. And then they would have money for imagining this piece of music. And I had a long discussion with Koda about this, because they did not think that it was musical, that it was music taking place. But still, it ended up in a good place. And yeah, I have to round it up so there's some time for questions. Also, yeah, that is important. I became intrigued by creating these sculptures, installations and or sculptures and or sound and or landscape and or music for instruments, where you would come into a room and you would experience in this case, 65 triangles hanging from the ceiling, and you would have earplugs in, because I found out that it's difficult to evoke an inner soundscape if there's a physical sound disturbing you. And then you would be asked to imagine the sound of these triangles hanging there. You could not touch them, and you should leave the room again, staying within the question about how it might have sound. Staying not having the answer, but letting the piece maintain the state of the superposition, as I talked about in the beginning, representing multiple realities, utopian realities, and also really embrace this feeling of not having the answer. We are so used to having the answer. We're going into and we look forward to something, and then we go to and see the movie, or we go to the concert, and we have the answer. And then we go out again and we feel that was nice, we had the answer. But in a way, I also thought that something were dying when I had when I got the answer. I also made this for 1,000 recorders, as you can see. Again, this imaginary soundscape you should look at and then imagine the sound of this. And let it allow to float within this this superposition. Yeah, this feeling of having answers. I had this experience along the way here. I wrote a piece for a Nordic saxophone festival where I wrote a piece for 30 saxophones. And then I wrote the piece and the score was finished and I looked at the score and there was like kind of an electricity around that score. And I know that feeling, and I think all of you know that feeling, that when the score was there, it represented like numerous different outcomes. It could sound like this or this or this or this or this, but all these realities would coexist at the same time. All these realities would coexist at the same time, and I would allow to, I could, in that period of time, after the score was finished until the concert took place, I would be free to navigate within all these realities, actually. And then I heard the piece and it was a nice piece, but I also felt like almost physically, like the superposition or the potentiality imploded. It turned into stone, it got saturated. And suddenly it was not like that interesting anymore. I had the answer, which of course gave me a satisfaction, but it also closed in on itself and became in a way more dull. And I began to wonder about like the perspectives of this in terms of, I also thought about this thing about after this concert had been there, I've heard the piece, then after a short while I began to be like not that calm, and I began like to have new ideas, and I wanted to make something new again and again and again, and I just came to think about this idea of the superposition again, and these like states of realities, you could say, and how I could perhaps learn to embrace this feeling of not having the answer, and thereby not experience the emptiness after that. I just forgot to mention another thing that was essential to me as this kind of quantum mechanics metaphor works for me. I also found a lot of inspiration in the material of plasma, which is like this a form of material. We know like solid and liquid state and gas state, and then there's the plasma state where material, where the electrons, they are almost like leaving the nucleus, and it's like this kind of material that is constantly like sits within like in this kind of very unstable nature, you work with plasma many places, but you work with plasma, that kind of plasma I'm interested in that is that plasma that you produce in these large colliders like CERN in Switzerland, for instance, where you like work with plasma that are so heated that it's like hoovering, it's floating within like this magnetic field within this collider, and it, if it would touch the walls of the collider, the plasma would burn, and also the walls itself would burn, and that plasma metaphor that really resonated with me in terms of my work, because the potential for 1,000 recorders, I really consider that, for instance, as plasma, as like this kind of installation and or sculpture and or sound and or landscape and or music, like it fluctuates between all these artistic domains and all these artistic discourses linked to these certain artistic domains, and and you cannot like approach the piece or approach the potential for 1,000 recorders as only sound, then it kind of changes in itself. Then it becomes, then it changes into stone. It refuses to identify with either of these disciplines. Yet, of course, it identifies with all of them at the same time because it's like it's trying to escape the same system that keeps it floating. You know, all these disciplines or artistic discourses are like the walls of the collider, and of course that is also there. That is what constitutes the magnetic field in which this potential is floating. So plasma is also a central key in reading these works, I think. I have to finish up, and I have to unfold the horizons in terms of especially this the sustainability of potentiality. And I would like to just one moment, I have to find this on my computer a moment. Here. So new to me, I'm sorry. One moment. So present. So and this. Okay. So let's see. Let's go into this. Can you see this? I hope you can. Okay, to open the present. It's a little appendix. Like speaking of superpositions and multiple realities coexisting at the same time, you often hear scientists say that it's theoretically an option that we one day can cross these boundaries of realities and travel across these dimensions and so on one day theoretically, and I think that sounds great, but I actually think that we already are capable of such thing, and we actually have like a sense, like we have like the eyes as a sense and the auditive sense and the nose, the smelling sense. but we also have like an interdimensional or multi universal sense that lets us know when we are about to lets us know when multiple realities are on the brink to converge with each other, when they are about to collide with each other, our alarms go off, and we know this feeling. And I've taken the liberty in these corona times to make a exponential growth paper here. I think we are all so skilled at looking at this, and it shows the ratio between Christmas Eve. We have Christmas here. This is the start of the December month. And then we have like the amount of butterflies in one stomach here. And as you can see in the beginning, perhaps this mostly applied to kids, but I also think adults, perhaps, yeah, me at least. In the beginning of December, the amount of butterflies is not that big. And then it actually rises, and it's almost an exponential growth when we reach Juleaften. And what is it that is happening? It is this expressed in another way. This is the beginning of December. We have here some multiple realities or possible realities outlined. This is just a fraction. There's countless, actually. This is the 1st of December. And then as we move through December, you can see all these realities, they get closer to each other. This must be around the 20th of December. and the 22nd of December, and the 23rd of December. And then we reach these hours just prior to opening the gifts, where our body tells us that now all these realities are just on the brink of colliding with each other. And we feel the amount of butterflies in our stomach rise, and we feel these realities soon to become extinct and become just one singular reality. All the other possible realities will disappear, the superposition will end, and we will open the present. So, as I wrote, we open the present, but we also enter the present. We choose a certain time, and we do that all the time. And then I think one of the perspectives is that what happens then after we open the present? Like it goes for all other of these experiences I talked about, like when we go to a movie and we see the movie, we have an answer. And the same goes for the present. We have an answer. We get what is inside the box. Sometimes we get happy, sometimes we get disappointed. And if we get happy, we play for a period of time. But what is for sure is that on the second that we have opened the present right here, a new series of possible realities will erupt again. And soon after opening this present, the satisfaction will be gone, and we will like sometimes feel an emptiness, and we will try to pursue like this feeling of butterfly again. And this is very, for me at least, very much linked to the act of consumerism, like that we want something and we buy something and we get something and we eat it, or we play it on our record player, or we read the book, and then we have done that, and then a kind of an emptiness appears because it's so dull just to be in one reality. It's way more fun to have access to these numerous potential realities. And there I'm questioning if, like, for instance, all of us adults, we know that if we go out tonight and we drink a lot of wine, we'll have a hangover. That is a kind of a knowledge. We know that it will be fun, but we also know tomorrow we'll have a hangover. And I'm just curious if we could like really train this sense or this kind of knowledge about the potentiality, that we know that when we leave potentiality, when we let all these realities collide into one, we are left with an emptiness. And if we could somehow train our capacity, our ability to remain within the potential state and not actualize it. So instead of course, it's very well known, but really embrace also the qualities instead of like looking at it as something that you miss. For instance, I'm a huge fan of the American composer James Tenney, and I really wanted to meet him at one point. And then I found out that he was dead just some month earlier, or some years earlier, actually. And of course, that made me sad, because it would have been a huge inspiration for me to meet him. But yet again, I never met him. And I think actually that it's kind of nice, not that he's dead, but that I did not meet him, because, okay, I would have met him. We have had a great time. I had that coffee, and I would have gone back to Denmark again or something like that. But by not meeting him, it's like this, I maintain this, it's like eternal potentiality. I think there's a notion one of my colleagues, Jakob, once coined in a mail to me, and this feeling of eternal potentiality, which is actually also, on one hand, you could say, oh, it was too bad that I did not meet him, but it's also soothing in a way that I just can go into these possible outcomes. And perhaps that could be a horizon of this, that we embrace potentiality. We don't go to Argentina and eat that steak. We remain at home, and we are not sad, oh, I wanted to go, but we just embrace this potentiality. So that is definitely one horizon, I think. And also I think in terms of the utopian one, I forgot that, but also what should we do? I talked about like a lot about like this saturated reality we are part of. How can we escape the systems? Perhaps we cannot, but I think we really have to try. And I think the answer is pretty forward. We should use our imagination. So if you wanted, for instance, to live in a plasticless society, then I would say, then let us really try to imagine a plasticless society. And it's a huge effort. I can already feel that now. How could we do that? How could that be possible? But if we really try to imagine it, then perhaps we would have the answers. But we should allow ourselves and really try to imagine this scenario, and then it would happen. And perhaps also leave the preconception that imagination is always an easy task. Sometimes you really should put in an effort to imagine something that is not there. Yeah, I think that is all I have for you. I think we have, I don't know how we can make questions and stuff here, but we can try, and I can try to write in the link below. So, there's a question here. There's a question from Morten. What's the considerations about the static state of the sculptures? Doesn't it solidify the potentiality rather than propose it? Yeah, of course, when placed on the floor, it will definitely evoke associations to a certain static, more static than if it's hung from the ceiling. So yes, I would love to hear about what you think. Oh, there's a lot of questions here. I like this. There's a question about this feedback. I like these closed loops. I when people are talking about feedback sessions, I get a little alert because feedback indicates like exactly this kind of closed system. It's a good question. I really don't think that necessarily that music only derives from music. I think it can derive some all kinds of domains, so to speak. Yeah, there was this question about the flute one again. Yeah, definitely. It's not, of course, as an artist, I of course I make choices. And the idea of something being completely without hierarchy, of course, that is not possible. So when I place recorders on the floor, of course, I choose and I make choices on behalf of the listener. So definitely, yes. Yeah, there's something about Marx and Engels. I love those two guys. Yeah. Time is kind of up. So I want to, I just pressed to see all these, how can I see all these comments? I don't know how I can see them. Well, I think I'll say thank you for now. It was a pleasure talking to you. Yes, and take care, everybody out there.